Hey, Jeff Justice here with Jeff Justice Seminars for Court Reporters. I want to thank you so much for deciding to choose us to get your online CEUs with. We promise not to disappoint you. We provide laugh-packed, content-rich seminars so that you can get your CEUs from the comfort of your own home or office. So basically, you're going to watch the videos as you do, print out the PDFs for the quizzes, answer the questions as you go along. At the end of the whole seminar, so if you're taking a 10-hour seminar after you finish all the sections, email me all of your answers. I will grade them and get you back your letter of completion for your state, and if you're an RPR, the proper forms for NCRA. So get ready to laugh and learn with Jeff Justice Seminars for Court Reporters. Hey, Juanita, thank you. Okay, and just real quick, Harry joined us about 2 years ago when Sue no longer was going to go on the boat. She'd had a stroke back in 2011. She's doing fine now. She just is not going to be traveling anymore. So she's part of our home study course. So two things, if you want to spend some time with Sue sometime, take the home study. And also she gets a portion of all the money we take in for the home study, so it kind of still helps her out too. So. And it's just like being in the room with Sue again. It's like hysterical. So I think we might have actually filmed that one in San Antonio. So Carrie was recommended to me in Illinois back then, and we thought we'd give her a try, and she must have worked out because this is now her third year going into doing programs with her here, and Carrie's also part of our online programs as well. So without any further ado, we also encourage you to create conversations like with all of our presenters here. If you don't agree with something that somebody up here says, please say something. Now, well, that's not the way I do it. I do it like this, with grace. Because the worst thing that we like to hear is at the end of the program, when somebody comes up and says, well, I didn't agree with what one of your teachers said, that was wrong. And I said, and you didn't share it so that everybody else could benefit from it, why? Because to me, I'm not a court reporter, it doesn't really help me, but it helps everybody else in the room. So, and also, if you have a question, you got to figure probably five or six other people have the same question. So, please make sure that you're an active participant in it, and that's how we make these seminars great. So without any further ado, all the way from Illinois, Carrie?
It's PK. PK,
I always say Q, don't I?
It's PK.
Did you notice I finally figured out how to do the E with the accent? I'm hoping it's gone right on my computer, okay? Carrie Piquet, the chair for her!
Good morning. It's wonderful to be here with you lovely ladies and gentlemen in the great state of Texas. I'm really enjoying your weather. When I get home tonight, it's probably going to be 40. I'm a reporter. I've been reporting since 99, and I have to say I love the Jeff Justice seminars. I've only attended throughout my career one other seminar that wasn't a Jeff Justice, and as you said, they're online now, too, so it's a great way. So thank you for spending your day with us. I'm sure you guys have transcripts and kids and families and everything else to do, but we need our credits. And this is going to, even though it's a long day, it's going to be a fun day. You just heard Anita speak after me. Pam's on. To talk about ethics, and she just brings a high level of energy, and then Jeff with his humor. So it'll be a fun day. Hope you enjoyed your lunch. I got a sandwich, it was pretty good. And if you guys need to take a restroom break, feel free. So today I'm presenting on proofreading. And by improving your proofreading skills, you cut down on your editing time and you increase your production. And if punctuation is used properly, it can greatly enhance the overall structure and organization and clarity of your writing. But if it's used incorrectly, it can be cumbersome and inhibit the reader's flow of the material. You can think of it as a road construction sign. Road signs warn the drivers of oncoming traffic or merging lanes, and punctuation similarly warns the readers of a flow and the shift of material. So we will go ahead and dive right into the first section, quotations, which is in my portion. It is pages 2 and 3. And take like 5-10 minutes, fill this out, and then we'll go over some answers together. It's not a race. There's quite a large number of people in the room, so people may finish at different times. So just stop at the, after the first section. Is everyone finished with the portion quotations? Okay. So for number one, he uses the word ludicrous too much. Where would you, somebody put the quotation marks in that sentence? Ludicrous, right? Just because they're emphasizing the word ludicrous, so quotation marks around ludicrous. Okay, sir in the green shirt, can you read number two, please? With the correct one.
Turning towards her brother, she cried, "Help." There were tears in her eyes, and clearly she was upset about something. "What's the matter?" he asked. I can't find our little sister," she answered.
Okay. Where would you put the quotations? Did you read?
I have it around the help.
Yes.
The first line. And the second line, starting with "what's." And then I put quotations after the question mark, after "matter," and I put a dash in between there. And then the third line, where it starts, "I can't," and then right after a comma, and then quotations.
Okay. Yes. Okay. So turning towards her brother, she cried, quotations around "help." There were tears in her eyes. There would be a comma there, and clearly she was upset about something. Then quotations around "what's the matter?" he asked, and then more quotations around "I can't find our little sister," she said.
Why do you have that question mark in the middle of the sentence? "What's the matter?" question mark, he asked.
Yeah, it should be a comma.
What's the matter?
He asked,
but
it keeps going.
Mm-hmm. You would not put the question mark? So probably you could put a comma there,
yeah,
then.
Put a comma.
Put a comma there instead of the question mark?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Who would like to do number three? Yes, ma'am.
That's your article. Shouldn't there be a comma before building a better vocabulary? And that's supposed to be building a better vocabulary.
Yes, she...
I would put a comma after article.
I would put a comma after article two. In his article, comma, quotations mean a better vocabulary.
Comma quotations.
Comma quotations. Darwin suggests making vocabulary development a personal mission of life. Is that what everybody has for that? Okay. Moving on to number four.
Quotation, "I don't care," comma quotation, "she said, what you think about it."
Right, and you would have quotations around "what you think about it" also, wouldn't you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So for number one, it would be quotation, "I don't care," quotation, "she said," and then she's continuing on with her thoughts, so quotation, "what do you think about it," close comma, quotation. Anybody else have something different? No? Okay, good. Okay, how about number five? This was an easy one.
No.
Nothing. That's correct. Laura's English professor asked her what was wrong. So nothing there. Number six.
"Around, could you and tell us some more stories?"
Yes, very good. Could you ask Lisa tell us some more stories? So quotations around the "could you" and then "tell us some more stories." Okay, how about number seven?
Quotation, "well," replied Tom, quotation, "you are incorrect this time," close quote.
That's correct. "Well," quotations around "well," replied Tom, quotations, "you are incorrect this time." And number eight?
But I would put a comma after interesting, because It's interesting and old story, so interesting.
She said she would put a comma after interesting and old stories. The children said that they would look for more books with interesting old stories.
I agree.
You agree with the comma?
Because you can switch it, they're interchangeable, and you can switch them around.
I was always
both modifying stories.
They're equal adjectives, yeah. Interesting story, old story.
Okay, because they're interchangeable, so you would put the comma?
That's what the
okay. I think you could do it either way, and it would still be correct, but if you like the comma, then that's fine. Okay, then in the next group, choose the correct sentence. They read the same, just a couple of punctuation marks, and they would make a difference. So what would be the correct?
B.
Yes. The book begins with this line, colon, and you can think of a colon as like a gate. It's a leeway into something. It was the best of times, comma, it was the worst of times. And then in quotation. What did you say, huh?
I was just saying, like, the first one, if it said the book begins with the line, then I would use the comma, but since it says this
line,
colon.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
She just said if it would have said the line, you wouldn't have used the quotation, but it's because it said this.
The
line.
I would have used the comma, but since it said this line.
It means that specific one.
Yeah.
That is cool. That's a good point. Okay. Okay, how about the next one?
A.
When you get to the beach, said Yadi, please call to let me know when you made it there. Why would B be incorrect?
Because
of the cat P, yeah. It's just continuing the same train of thoughts. You don't need to cap that. Okay, how about the next one?
B.
It's a single, I'm sorry, it's B because what?
Oh, I was just saying. Because there is a single quote around Africa because it's already in quoted materials.
Mm-hmm. Right. It's a single quote around Africa because it's already within quoted materials. That's correct. Okay. The next one?
Okay.
Yes. A is correct.
Except for Kelly's misspelled. No, I'm just joking.
It is.
We just spelled two different ways.
Two different ways. We have some good proofreaders.
Yeah.
That is good.
Okay, let's go on to the next one.
A.
She said, he said, hurry up. You're saying if the comma wasn't there?
No, I'm saying like on B, if the comma wasn't after said, then it could be like that. But since there's a comma,
It's
A. Okay, and then the last one on this page. A. Right. Girls summarizes how we think we can improve our lives. Colon, simplify, simplify. And I wanted to bring this, since we're on the topic of quotations, I wanted to bring this up. When you're in a deposition and an attorney's reading something and he says, quote, and then he starts reading, what do you guys usually do in that situation?
Write up a quote.
And then you didn't hear what I said? I just said if you're no, it's okay.
Sorry. Apparently my voice carries more than I think it does. I'm really sorry.
When you're in a deposition, if the attorney says I'm quoting, Then I would put the words quoting in there. I am quoting, and if you see the particular document they're reading from, then I do it. But if he just says quote, and you know that he's reading correctly from the document, then I wouldn't put the word quote. I would just put the quotation marks.
So you do not write the word quote out. And he said quote, I was restored. You leave that quote out and you just put the quotation marks?
Yes.
He said it.
What is your question again?
And he said, quote, I was restored. You put the word quote in.
Yes.
And he said, quote.
And that instance, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And the document says, quote, whatever. The word quote you put in.
The word quote. In some circumstances, yes, if they're saying it like that, but if he's just saying quote and then he starts reading it from a document, then I would put the word quote.
My favorite thing that they're doing now is when they read the documents, they're saying, you know, the state of Texas print, da-da-da-da-da print, close print, and they just run it all out.
Oh, yeah.
And then he said parentheses, print. What do you put? P-A-R-N.
You
just put the parentheses.
I just put the parentheses. But then they say, oh, but this sometimes leads to a lot of confusion too, because then they're like, I was just working on a doctor's step, and it was one word that he pulled out, and he's like, open print, close print. So you had to read it two or three times to decipher which word he wanted in the parentheses. So, but I just put the parenthesis mark around the word, whatever they're saying. Unless you don't know what they really want in parentheses, so you just put open, close, print, and go on like that.
Can you put the words down?
I would if you're not sure what they're...
It's not a real word, they're just saying print. Is everybody
A-R-E-N. But if it's confusing...
But the hard thing is it's in a quoted material.
It's in quoted material.
I'm reading the quoted material that says contract of so-and-so print, contract,
capitalize,
you know how they do it.
And
they
say print in there,
it's in all quoted
material,
so if you
do
close your quotes, do your dash, put print, open your dash. I mean, I'm just curious, I'm asking.
Anybody have a way to suggest to her how to do that?
Oh, because it doesn't read well, yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't read well, because it makes it more confusing to bother with those exact words than to just go ahead and use the quotes document that you have the exhibit there to confirm it with, and just make sure the transcript is clear rather than the exact words.
So sometimes it's like, you know, they're saying comma. You know, they're like, well, they're reading it and they're saying the actual comma.
That's true. That's a good way to think about a thing. If they're reading something, they say comma, period, you're not going to type in the word comma. You're not going to type in the word period. So I think just to make it clear and concise, don't junk it up with a bunch of unnecessary stuff in there. Does that kind of help you out? It's going to have the symbol, right?
Yeah, they're wrong, so I'm
going to
put
them
exactly
the same. Okay, now I want you to turn to your neighbor and I want you to discuss the funniest thing you've seen in a transcript or an embarrassing thing. And I really couldn't think of anything too funny that I've seen in a transcript, but this was quite embarrassing. A reporter in my office, in one of her transcripts, she put Mr. Wolf all the way through. I don't know what was on her mind, lack of sleep or whatever, but she had Mr. Fox throughout the whole transcript. Needless to say, that one got sent back, you know? She was thinking animal species, animal kingdom, but that one came back. So talk amongst yourselves and we'll come up with a few, see if you guys have any examples of funny or embarrassing that you've seen in a transcript. Okay. I hear lots of giggles and laughter, so we must have come up with some really funny or embarrassing things in a transcript. But anybody like to share something? It's fine if it's inappropriate.
It's fine.
Right. It's fine.
Well, it wasn't in a transcript, but
oh, okay.
It was like it came up on my.
She has an inappropriate example. It wasn't in a transcript, and that's. I'm gonna repeat it so you guys can hear in the back. Okay, go ahead.
I was running campus.
She was running campus.
And it came up as damp pussy.
Oh, wow.
So I quickly changed that.
She was riding campus, and it came up as.
Say it again.
Damp. And I don't know why.
P-U-S-S-Y. Oh, wow. That's embarrassing. Yes? Okay, hold on, ladies.
It's just something that happened. It just cracked me up for 20 years. And it involves an attorney in Houston. If y'all all work with him, he's a nice guy. He actually laughed with me after it was over. But his name is Clintus. They already got all the way through trial. We got judgment. He's just searching for the money. So these attorneys are sick to death of each other. They've already chewed each other up. So we're just sitting there in this little judgment depot trying to find money. And the opposing counsel kept going, "All right, Mr. Clint's ass." I thought he was going to have an aneurysm. He was turning purple, and he says, "I want the record to reflect that he's put the emphasis on the last half of my brain." I just stared at him on the sheet. I can't even look up because I'm afraid I'm going to start
laughing.
So afterwards, he walked out with me. He says, "As if my name isn't horrible enough."
Oh, no. Okay, she was in a proceeding, and they kept referring to the attorney's name as
Clint's ass.
And so the attorney's like, "Please let the record reflect they're putting emphasis on the last part of my name." And then after that, she was leaving, he's like, "As if my name isn't bad enough already." Okay, any more funny or embarrassing? Any more funny or embarrassing things in a transcript?
When I misstroke able, it comes up anal.
When she misstrokes able, it comes up as anal. So it's a good thing we're able to figure those out. We fix them pretty quick.
Yeah.
I'm trying to figure that one out.
I don't know why P-U-S came up as P-U-S. That's why.
Maybe the word "I" was
after.
Was it "I" apple?
Maybe. I don't know. I was like, "Oh my goodness."
Okay, any other funny stories? Okay. Well, then we'll move on to capitalization. And we'll take 5 or 10 minutes of complete those. Okay, are we all finished with this section? Everybody's done with capitalization? Okay. Would somebody like to read number one?
The Baseball Hall of Fame is in Cooperstown, New York. And I would say fame should be capitalized.
Fame. That's correct. And number one, the Baseball Hall of Cap Fame in Cooperstown, New York, because that's the whole title. Number two. Can you read number two for me?
Yes.
Oh, okay. On Memorial Day, I will capitalize day.
Yes.
I visited Arlington. I will capitalize National, capitalize Cemetery with my father, but I would do a
lowercase for father. Because that's used as a pronoun there, and you're putting my father also. It's a pronoun, and then it precedes the, so it's not the father's full name. Okay, number three, would somebody like to read number three? Yes, sir.
In the spring, I would put spring in lowercase.
Correct.
Of 1999, I graduated from Hollywood High School in Los Angeles, California.
That's correct. And number three, this gentleman said the only thing that he would not cap is spring because seasons are not supposed to be capped. And for some reason, I think sometimes they look like they should be capped. I don't know.
It really looks like it ought to be capped there.
It does, but we're just not supposed to. So that's one of the things I think you could get away with either or. I mean, nobody's going to send a transcript back for that. But, okay. Who would like to take number four?
I wouldn't capitalize license plates.
You're right about that. Lowercase for the license plates. And everything else is correct, right? Would you put an apostrophe after Illinois for Illinois license plates?
I wouldn't.
No? Okay. I didn't think so, just wondered. Okay. Number five.
Change winter and change desert.
Change winter and change desert. That's correct. Every winter, you would do winter in lowercase. My boyfriend George heads to the Mojave. You would capitalize desert and sings Bob Dylan songs.
But I think George should have a comma before and after.
My boyfriend George? Because there's only one boyfriend, so you're setting up. Okay, so and that one too, you can also put commas around George.
I thought the rule was the opposite.
You thought the rule was the opposite?
But if it's only one, then you don't use the office. But if it's like my son and you have five sons.
I think what she's thinking of is renaming. She's renaming him instead of saying,
yeah.
My brother, Tom.
It's the same thing.
Mm-hmm. But you're right, but she's just doing it because it's renaming instead of my boyfriend taking the place of. Okay, number six.
Kleenex and iPhone.
Mm-hmm. Yes, capitalize the names of brands. But for iPhone, it's actually a small I and then a capital P. And there is no dash in there.
Oh, no dash in iPhone?
No. I don't know, I haven't seen the new iPhone yet. I don't know. Yeah. Okay. Let's see how you guys would do number seven. Anyone want to take a status?
Huh?
And how about chairman of the board? No. You would capitalize it?
No.
See, they say that if it preceded Mr. Smith, the chairman of the board, Mr. Smith, it would be capped because that's his direct title. But it says if it comes after, not to cap. And but it's not prominent. Like if it was Barack Obama, the President of the United States, then you would, because it's prominent name. Or like, you disagree? I mean, you could leave it. I mean, it kind of looks important, but just chairman of the board, yeah. But for our exercise here, I would say not. To cap it. Okay, number eight.
I said the E in English.
Uh huh.
That's the only thing.
And math.
But you could just keep consistent. I was just going to do science just because it was
good. Sorry.
Well, would you care to share that?
You want to speak for yourself?
Well, we said cap English because it's, you know, proper. And then we said cap math because it's the title was 100. And then I said I would probably cap sciences because it's all together.
You don't want to leave it out, yeah. And that's what she set up here, too, just to make it consistent, cap all of them. So consistency is key, I think. So, but really, English and math definitely should be capitalized. And if you don't want to leave science feeling left out, you can capitalize that one too. You didn't capitalize it? Okay. Yes, sir.
I'm probably just going to start trouble in the middle of your exercise.
No, good. Please do.
This is the question.
Okay.
So, for the officials, Your Honor, capital Y or no?
Yeah, capital
Y. Oh, yeah.
That's what I wanted to do. I was just curious.
You capitalize it?
Your Honor, go for it. Yeah, I was just curious if anybody else does lowercase y.
Let's have a consensus here. How many people do capitalize the Y?
Absolutely.
And how many don't? For Your Honor?
I used to,
but
I don't anymore.
I capitalized honor.
I was taught in school not to capitalize the Y for your and then capitalize honor. It's a preference type thing. Yes, ma'am.
What about the president?
The president? You would cap that. Say no. You would do everything like that. A single. Well, I think that you could just keep on doing it however you're doing it and how it works for you. Are you an official?
Yeah.
Your judge probably likes it. How do you do it for your judge?
Well, I usually cap everything, Your Honor. Yeah, but we very seldom do transcripts for that court's judge's seat. So,
Okay.
But I work in a pool with a pool of people. There's six of us, and I mean, two or three people do it lowercase y, and let's do a capital Y. I was just curious.
I think it depends on the way we were taught. I really think it.
I've worked in court all my life, and I've always capitalized.
You've always capitalized it. Yeah. Okay. Well, however you do it, just keep doing it that way. But good question. Good question. Okay. I believe we're on 9 now, right? On St. Patrick's Day. Anybody like to read that one? Any Irish people in here? Volunteer for that one. You're out? Okay. Can you? The one with the lowly court reporters?
Cap Irish.
On St. Patrick's Day, my family always makes, capitalize the I in Irish stew. Okay. Number 10. President Barack Obama's health care plan, I would not capitalize health care plan. Right, because that's not the name of it. Wasn't liked by many U.S., and you notice here I don't have U, period, S, and I don't know how you guys are doing that, but in Greg it says not to. But I like it with the dots in it. And then senators would be lowercase, because it's not speaking of specific senator. It wasn't liked by many senators, some senators, it's not speaking of a specific one. U.S. senators.
Because if they say Houston police officer, then I capitalize all three.
I do too, that's a good point. She has a good point over here. She, just like if Houston police officer, she capitalizes H-P-O, but if it's just police officer, she doesn't. So that's a good point. So maybe we might want to leave senators captain since it's saying the U.S. senators. Okay, so we'll cap senators there. Any questions on that one? Okay, number 11. Who said A? Okay. She said, bees are not the only insects that sting. Okay, because when you're starting something within quotations, that's capped. The first word is capped, unless it's added a run on. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And here's a typo in here, and I don't know on the next one. It should be pleaded. So,
oh,
yeah. But that would have been wrong anyways because of the capital T. So who would like to read that one? Do you want to read that one?
You must understand, comma, I pleaded, comma, that I need more time to complete the transcript.
With the capital T or the low, the lowercase?
The lowercase.
The lowercase, because it's a continuing thought, right? Okay. And here's kind of another one.
A.
Right. He's not vice president. Did I hear somebody say that?
That was me again.
Your voice carries.
It really does. No, I was saying because he's not the vice president of the United States.
Okay, so Mark Cuban, the president and owner of the Mavericks, made an illegal bet against his team. That would be A, don't cap the vice president. No, it's not true. I don't think he's betting against his team.
It's a Pete Rose thing.
Yeah. It's a Pete Rose?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
You're too young.
I'm too young. What did Pete Rose do?
He bet against his team.
Well, no, not against his team. Oh, I'm thinking of Derrick Rose from the Bulls. Not Derrick Rose. Pete Rose?
Yeah. He's got a commercial now where he's not allowed to go down the hallway of his house.
Wow. Okay, number 14. Right. Number 14 is A. I live in the northeastern part of the state where the climate is colder. Does somebody disagree with that? Does somebody think northeastern should be capped? No. It's an adjective describing a part, it's not a region. Okay, how about 15? It is B, and because the West is a specific region, it can be used as part of the noun, the Wild West. So that's B. The Capital West, especially California, is famous for its cutting-edge fashion. Okay, and then number 16. Somebody say A? Yeah, it would be A. Because you want to cap the second bureau in there, right? Because they're just shorting in it. I would do it throughout the whole transcript. She had a good question. She said, do you just capitalize the bureau there because it's in the same sentence, or would you do it throughout the whole transcript? I would do it throughout the whole transcript.
So if it was... So somebody said the city of Houston, and then they just kept saying the city, you would cap that?
I would cap the city, because they're using it as an entity.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry?
Well, because it's referring to a proper.
It's speaking to the city as in the...
So you're saying it would have to be
more
the city, the
If it's in the transcript a lot and they're using the city as the entity, yes, as
the city regulates.
Whatever. Did you kind of get it? Okay.
Does
anyone want to add anything about the capitalization? Anything that gives you trouble in capitalization. Okay, before we move on to the next section, I'd like you once again to turn to your neighbor and discuss the most challenging punctuation usage that you have. It could be the serial comma, the Oxford comma. That one kind of trips me up sometimes. Like, do you put in, when you have a series, the last comma and? No, you guys don't. I started doing it because, like in a caption, if you, and I know you're supposed to leave the caption as it is, but if you don't put in for the last and, it could just really confuse things. And you're thinking that last person named isn't a defendant, it's part of it. So, yeah. So, just talk, or one word, two word hyphenating, just talk amongst yourself and talk what gives you the most difficulty in punctuation. And we'll share a few. Does anybody want to share something that's difficult for them?
Yeah. I have a couple of things.
Yes.
That have recently come up. And I've been recording a long time and I still struggle with some of this stuff. And sometimes it just depends on how you feel that day. But
that's very true.
But when an attorney is quoting a sentence, and say he by some chance accidentally quotes it correctly, because we know they never do, right? But say he quotes it correctly, but within the quoted material there's something in parens, but he doesn't say the parens. What do you guys do?
Okay, she has a scenario. She's been reporting a long time, and sometimes things come up. She doesn't know what to do, and the attorney's quoting something, and in the middle of the quotes, it's something in a paren, but he doesn't say that it's in a paren. What would you do?
Leave it out.
You would leave it out? Because he didn't say it?
No. But then to me, it's not a correct quote.
Right. It's not a correct quote.
So I would, no.
See, if you had the exhibits, you could look and just stick it in there.
He read the entire part, but he just didn't say the word parentheses around it.
Yes. You did what?
I go with the document as if he's reading the document and I can look at it. I'm always reading the document.
Yeah, if I had the document and I saw the prints in there, I would put it. Even if he didn't read it. Or another option, which you might not want to do, is you could dash it because he's quoting and he doesn't say it. You could dash it because he's. And then.
But is that like him reading the commas? That there's commas? You can say the comma part, even though we know it's in and we can see it. You put that comma.
That's right.
I don't know. I would put parentheses document here, not
in the parentheses. She would put the print if she saw it in the document.
Okay, one other question.
Okay, another question.
You have a quoted sentence.
You have a quoted sentence, yes.
He quotes it right. It ends in a exclamation point, or what I had last week was it ended in two question marks, because it was very important to the person writing it that question, are we doing this? Well, he just read the sentence. So do you put in exclamation points and two question marks?
We're not supposed to put exclamation marks in ours.
But it's quoted.
Yeah, it's quoted.
Is it quoted?
Yeah, it's in the
quoted
materials.
It's the end of the quoted sentence.
Okay, even if he didn't say it. So I wouldn't. In that situation, I would not. If he didn't say it.
It's anything.
It's an interesting notion because it's the spoken word that you're taking down. Not, I mean, in a sense, not what's on the document. You know, so yeah.
That's right. Yeah. That you said it's the spoken word that we're taking down, not what's on the document.
Right.
And that's important because remember, the spoken word remains and the written or unspoken word vanishes. But sometimes they might be picky, I had it there for emphasis, well then you should have said it because I'm not even supposed to put an exclamation mark in my transcript. You know? Or if you put it in, then sit. But then I don't think that I would put it in
at all. Okay, but then that ends the sentence.
Yes.
I'm gonna quote this, he quotes it. It ends in two question marks. He doesn't say them. How do you end the sentence?
How do I end the sentence? Oh, yeah, God.
If he's quoting it the way it's read, it's a, he's quoting it correctly.
The words, but he didn't say the two question marks.
Yeah, but the sentence itself, it is a question.
So you only put one, and there's two there?
Yeah, I only put one. I'd only put one, or if you put
two. No, I totally disagree with
you. You would put... Okay, well, you can, no, you can disagree, but you would go ahead and put the two on.
Yes, I think it changes the flavor.
I'm sorry, I'm just kind of like trying to make sure I'm in sequence with what you guys are saying. So you're saying that there's a question, someone asks a question, did your question say, and then you read the question, the question is important material because it's like an up of a note.
Right.
A document.
An email.
Okay. And that email has two question marks in it in the quoted material.
And that's the end of that answer.
So
you have to put punctuation.
Did you put in an email, John, are we going to go to the store?
Question mark.
Okay. I was trying to make sure I was in
sequence. Yeah, right. And he doesn't say any punctuation. So what do you do?
But he's asked a question. The question mark goes inside the quoted material.
She wants to know if she should put the two question marks there.
I think if it's a quote, you're going to have to put the exclamation. If it's a quote, you're going to have to, even though we're not supposed to determine whether it's a this or that. But if it's quoted material, then we have the document and we see it, that might be an instance where you would put this. And I'm going to quote. And I think if the double question mark is important, just question. Okay, ma'am.
She said if the double question mark was important, he would have mentioned it.
But that's not true. It might be important to the other side.
It might be important to the other side.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, then the other side. But then you have it compared to the other side could step up and say, hey, this ends in a double question mark.
That's the way I would do it, but.
So how would you end it?
If it's a question, I'd end it in one question mark.
Is it?
You wouldn't put both, right?
I would.
Even though it has to be both parts?
Yeah.
That's just so tricky.
I know, it is.
It is tricky, but you know, maybe they didn't even put it for emphasis. Maybe it was a typo because it's in an email, and people in email and text, they don't
in text. And if something is misspelled, like...
something's misspelled within the core material. You don't leave them misspelled
all the way through, but I'm
still spelled right. Yeah, that's a good point, that you don't correct the misspelled words. Okay. Any more questions?
You would call what you corrected if it was within a code?
Then the spelled word? Because he's still saying the correct word.
Yeah.
Maybe not quote.
Okay. Any more questions along those lines of in quotations or difficult punctuation? Okay, then let's go on and go to our writing numbers section and take a few minutes to answer those. Okay, is everybody finished with the writing numbers? Yes? Okay. How about the gentleman with the plaid green shirt? Can you read number one, please?
Number one, choose the correct sentence. I picked B. I asked for two copies each for my 12 employees.
Okay, I chose A, and there is, and the next one we'll talk about it a little bit further, but for this number one, I asked for two copies in words for each of my 12 employees. It's a different subject. It's employees and copies of paper. So.
I would be consistent.
You would be consistent either way.
Spell both of them out or write both of them out.
And I think you can do that, but this is a different subject, and that's the reason that I did it here. But the number one rule in writing numbers is consistency, so do it that way. So your answer could be right if you wanted to be consistent. Okay, how about number two? Who picked B? Okay. Well, for the correct answer, I have A. If only five people show up instead of 11, you're talking about people, the same subject, will you give, will you still give your speech? So I have A. But you're, you guys could, if you want to be consistent, you could do B. Okay, number three? A, right. One-fifth of the inventory was ruined. One-fifth with the fraction, and you always spell out numbers at the beginning of a sentence. Somebody read number four?
I'll do it.
Okay, thank you.
The tree grew only 5/10 of an inch because of the drought. I assume that's drought.
The drought is misspelled.
Drought is misspelled.
Yeah.
Okay,
but yeah, I think
good choice. Go with B. Yeah, you should precede the decimal with the zero. Yes, you should.
Like 38. Like 38 is that way, isn't it? 0.38. Oh, sorry.
No, you got me confused on that. 0.38. Huh? Oh, it's not. Okay.
So
everybody disagrees with you.
Everybody
disagrees with
four? To go with A.
To go with A?
Don't put the zero.
You don't put the zero.
It's going to depend how it's made. Yeah, if they say 0.5, I'd put 0.5.
Okay, so only if they say the zero before you would put it?
Yeah.
Okay, and I'm thinking about it, yeah, because you don't want to add something that's not in there. So if they don't say, okay, so we're changing. Four is A. We're not going to put the zero before the decimal unless they say it.
I've got another question.
Yes.
Say on number two.
Okay.
Only five people showed up. Are you going to spell it out or are you going to put it in a new one? Only five people show up.
Mm-hmm.
What are you doing with that five? Is it a numeral or is it a... Are you going to follow the 0 to 10, it gets written out, and anything above 10 goes numeral? And then later on down in the transcript, they said, well, actually 11 showed up. So if you've got a 5 up here written out, and then down here you have an 11, you're going to put the numeral? I struggle with this daily. Because my screen reader's like, everything goes numerals until 10.
It's only
11
if
through whatever. Okay. Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't.
Okay. She was taught to write, ma'am, anything under 10 you spell out.
Right, right.
That's what
and
I
then
learned.
10 and over.
Or 11 and over.
11 and over. Sometimes it's 10, sometimes it's 11.
Yeah, right.
I was always. Okay. If only five people show up instead of 11. I just did that as consistency because they're both people. But if you want to follow the rule of 10 and under spelled out, that's going to make it easier as it comes up in the transcripts later, so you're not having to think about the 11.
I'm trying to, you know, it's we're constantly thinking about, okay, which goes here, which goes there. I just want to make it consistent and easy through the whole thing. If I'm going to use a 5 as a numeral up here, I'm going to use 11 as a numeral down here because it, to be consistent. Everybody says be consistent, so you're either going to write it out or you're going to put a numeral. To me, it's not consistent if you write 5 out and then you say 11 in a numeral on down your page.
But would you still spell out the 5 then?
That's what I'm saying. To follow the rule, you're supposed to do 10 and under is spelled out.
Okay, so then let's... I see what you're saying, and that's a good point. And for consistency and clarity, I think that should be changed to B. So when it comes up later on, you're just following the rule. If it's 10 and under, you spell it out. 11, you put in numerical format. So I like that. So that's consistent. So we are changing 2 to B. Okay. And I have one thing, and this should come up in the next section in the pastor's fees, but I'm going to bring it up right now before we do number five. I hate it when people say it happened in 25. Talking about 2005.
Oh.
Yeah.
That is so confusing.
24.
What do you do?
No.
Zero apostrophe.
Zero. What?
25. 2-0. What that?
I can't. I'm making it too difficult. I'm just making it too difficult to read. Y'all know what they're saying.
So what I usually do is 2005. I leave it like that instead of racking my brain how to do it.
That would be like if you were going to say 2-0 and 5 and write that out. You know what they're trying to say, and it's just making it too difficult and unreadable.
Yeah, too difficult and unreadable.
25.
What about
25?
No, when they're saying
25 for 2005.
Right.
That's how my recruiter did it.
You like the recruiter did it and liked it? Okay, if that works. Yeah. Okay, so we're on number five. Ladies and gentlemen,
okay.
Sir, will you read it, please?
Michael Jordan did more free throws in 05 than he did in 06. I would, number B.
Correct.
Apostrophe, 05, apostrophe, 06.
Correct. 5 is B with the apostrophes in it. Okay, number 6.
B.
Because you once again spell it out because it's at the beginning of a sentence, right? 45 families were displaced because of the mudslide. Okay, number 7. How about this gentleman with the pledge right there?
Thurgood Marshall was the first African American to serve on the U.S. Supreme Court. B.
That's correct. Because it's expressing the order of something. That's why it's spelled out.
Is this an African American hyphenated?
Is African American hyphenated?
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Yes.
I gotta look this up real quick if I have Wi-Fi in here. I never thought about that.
It is.
Why don't you know what to look?
I think we're lying.
Well, what's the rule for that? For African American to be hyphenated?
Politically correct.
Oh, it's politically correct?
Politically correct.
Yeah.
I just want to show the aesthetically pleasing.
Irish, Indian,
German, American, I've got it long. I just looked it up on Google and it pops up sometimes hyphenated, sometimes not. But then are you going to hyphenate Mexican American?
Irish American.
Okay, I'm not going to start doing it unless somebody complains. I'm not going to hyphenate it. But the person that does keep doing it, but I never heard that brought up until just now. You know, there are cookies back there. I don't know if you're allowed to get some or if you're supposed to wait. Are you supposed to wait till the break? Oh, sorry, you guys have to wait till the break for the cookies. Okay, go ahead.
Check your hands when you come back. That sounds strange, I'm sorry.
Okay. We're on number 8.
Number
Yes.
Oh, I kind of chose you to say, I wasn't long term, but I will.
Thank you.
I chose A, the Rio Grande is the 22nd longest river in the world.
That's correct. You chose B?
Yeah.
And why did you choose B?
Oh, girl.
Because it's over 10? Okay, but when you're expressing the order of things, it's supposed to be spelled out.
Heavens, murder Troy.
Okay. Well, did you want to say something? You look like you were...
Nope.
Okay.
What did you say the rule was?
It's expressing the order of things.
And so it's supposed to be written out?
Yeah.
Oh, we got a good one on the next one.
Well, you can use the rule of consistency there if you want, but and also because it's over 22, you could.
If you have to say 9, this is going to be a thing.
Yeah, that's a good thing. However, that one makes you happy, do it. Okay, how about number 9?
So, like they say
that? Ma'am? I'm sorry?
I said neither was, but we have a little conflict on one thing about it.
The hockey? What's your conflict?
Wait, I thought running numbers is what this thing was, not that hockey shouldn't be tapped.
Oh, you're right. Okay. But no, that has nothing to do with the sentence. It's about writing numbers.
A, I think it should be a digit.
Correct.
I think it's wrong because to me that would be 9 o'clock and clock. Right?
It's redundant.
Right.
It's redundant. And that's just the way that I was taught in school. So I leave it. It is redundant.
If they say o'clock, then you still put the
o'clock. If they say o'clock, you still put the o'clock, even though it's redundant.
But I guess you could spell time.
Because time, dates are supposed to be numbers. Were you going to say something else?
Well, the 9 calendar there to be is the same. It's 5. So that's just saying 9.
Right. So you would take off the o'clock?
No, I would add the o'clock to the 7.
Yes, right.
But just the 9 calendar there, it's telling you.
It's 9 o'clock.
Not
really.
That's right.
Okay, how about number 10?
A.
Who said that?
A.
The properties in the community start at about $1 million spelled out. And why would you spell it out?
Because they didn't say $1 million. They said $1 million.
$1 million. Okay. Number 10 should be A. Say $1 million. They said $8 million. And I also tend to spell larger numbers out. Both right?
If they say $1 million, then you put the dollar sign. If they say $8 million, you put the A and spell
out. Okay. So they're saying they're both right. So that's okay. They're both right. Depending on what they say.
Well, yeah, because B doesn't have the A in it.
Right.
So I had a question recently where they constantly change the way they said it. They'd say 1,000,004, 1,000,004, 1,500,000, 1,500,000, what they said it. Any way you
think of. They kept changing it. They said what?
1,59,762.
Right. I mean, they changed it 1,000,000 times. 1,500,000, 1,000,005.
It's like if they did 1,000,004, I would do 1,000,000,004. And if they said 1,000,004, I'd do A, the word 1,000,004.
Did you spell it out in words?
Million I did. Now if they did like $1.4 million, I would do dollar sign 1.4 and the word million. Yeah. But they just kept shifting it the whole time.
What's she saying about the hyphen?
If it's a hyphen, and when would you use the hyphen? If they said...
If they use like a million four?
A million four?
A million four. I would do A, the word A, and then the word B, yeah. But if they said it was 1 million 4, if I were just 1 million 4, then I would 1 hyphen A and hyphen 4.
That, yeah, some of these things are so confusing when they say it so many different ways. And so I think you did the right thing. You just did the best you could do with it, and...
Yeah.
Put it in like that.
That's hard. Yeah.
Okay, how about moving on to apostrophes, ladies and gentlemen? Let's
can I ask a question?
Hold on before we...
Yes.
This is how I do it, and I was just wondering, like when they say, is it $10 or $20? I don't put the dollar sign just on the $20. I write the word dollars after, because I...
Hold on, I'm trying to wrap my head around this. If they say, is it 10?
Is it 10 or $20? So to be consistent to me, I just write the word dollars out because there's not a dollar sign on the 10 and the 20.
Right. So no dollar sign then, right? At all? Spell dollars out. Did everybody get her question? If they say, is it $10 or $20, you don't put the dollar sign, you just put the 10 or 20 and then spell dollars out. I'm sorry, did somebody say something different? What would you do?
I just say the word, because the dollar sign doesn't go with one or the other.
It's like exactly. The word goes, exactly. That's what she's saying, just the word. Yeah. So that was an easy one to figure out.
Yeah, I like it
when that one. Do you do 20? Yeah. Write it out. Spell it out. Is 20 spelled out?
Why? You want to know if the 20 is spelled out. And why would you spell the 20 out?
It's consistent with 10.
No, it's money. You don't spell the 10 out again. It's a digit for money.
Okay.
Digit for money. Yeah. But I do a lot of workers' comp cases, and when they talk about 66 and two-thirds, I spell that out. I do 60 and hyphens, 66 and two-thirds, instead of trying to mess around with the two-thirds. And so I just spell that out. You write out two-thirds too. Yes, do you have a question?
I have a question. I'm just curious how everybody does this. If they say, they're in the middle of the sentence, and they say it's 4 or 564, like they're thinking in their head, is it 400 or 564, whatever.
Is it dollars?
4 or 564. Dollars.
Okay, her question is, they're thinking about it in their head, and they're speaking as they're thinking, as they always do. Is it $4 or $564?
Is it four or five sixty-four? But they didn't finish the 464. They just said, is it 4 or 564?
I would put the number 4, and then
you would put the number 4,
and then the rest of what happened.
Or would you put 4 with the happened there? You know how, like.
Well, I'm trying to grasp what they're trying to say. They're not completing.
They're not completing.
My job just dash.
Thank you.
Dash
it?
Well, not a dash, as in an interruption.
Hyphen. Like a hanging, a suspended hyphen is what you're doing. You're suspending it together. Okay. Yeah, that's confusing because you don't know what they're trying to say. So the hyphen kind of ties it all in together.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions on writing numbers? No? Okay. Let's move on to apostrophes, ladies. Okay, can we work while you guys have food in your mouth? Okay. Good. On number one, on apostrophes, I should have put an example in there. The question reads as, to show possession with pronouns, never use apostrophes. And I should have given an example there, such as ours, theirs. So what would you say, true or false? That's correct, true. So did everybody get that? Number one is true? Okay. And this is a bonus, not that, well, I'll have your cookies and sweets already, but this is a bonus question. Okay, number two, the apostrophe has two uses, possession and contractions is true. And then what is another usage for an apostrophe?
To show missing letters, wait, two. So I
believe I said that. To show missing letters? Well, to...
In numbers like 25.
In numbers like the 25? Yeah, to, anything to like clarify, yeah. Not missing letters, though.
That's
right.
I misspoke.
There's a thing like fracking.
They say F and O.
Like what? They say like what?
Fracking.
Fracking. Fracking how?
The missing G.
Well, no, for fracture. For fracture.
Okay. I never knew about the apostrophe before. If somebody says F M, you put the F apostrophe I N G. Ah, instead of dashing it, but you still going to do the dashes too?
No.
No dashes. Oh, interesting. So if someone's saying a bad word, use the apostrophe in place of those.
Well, if they say it,
no, like
oh, if they're saying effing. Oh, if they're saying effing. That effing cop. Okay. Yeah. Okay. You have lots of good points. You have lots of good points. Okay,
this will be right about
everything.
And this had their good points.
I choose that look that made me feel bad.
No problem. Okay, let's move on to number three. Going through other, you say B?
Because it says there and them, so there's more than one person.
So everyone agrees that three is B. Okay. Okay.
It's already plural,
so you're just adding the apostrophe. Okay, or men. So I'm just giving examples up here. I'm tough for the camera. Okay, so three is B. What'd you say?
I forgot the camera was on,
we're
sitting here talking away.
That's okay. Number four. And, okay, yeah. And that's for clarity's sake, right?
And you're missing letters.
Yes. So four, the bodybuilder liked to work on his tries and buys with an apostrophe in there. Yeah. It looks like what?
As another one, it looks like Tris and this.
Tris and this, yeah.
So what about yeses and nos?
I'm sorry?
So how would you do yeses and nos? Would you do the apostrophe and no apostrophe s? Yes is nothing.
Yeses and nos?
Good question.
Yes. What
about
no?
Yeses.
Yeses
and
noes. Well, you would add the ES to make it plural and then possessive. The nose is N-E-N-O-E-S. You wouldn't do that?
No.
I do. I'd put ES. We're talking about plural?
Yes.
ES.
Yeah. You don't like that? You would put the apostrophe S for nose? Is that what you're saying?
Then why aren't we following the same? Why is there an apostrophe S for tries and buys?
You should have no S.
And tries and buys, just to make it read clear. Just to make it read clear. But inception. Yeah. You might have an option for what?
Yeses and noes.
There's options for yeses and noes. But she's saying that tries and buys is like the yeses and no's.
The CEP is.
You have more than one tries and buys.
You're filling in the CEP.
Yes and no is not always plural.
Okay. Yes and no is not always plural. Tries and buys are always plural. Is that helping you out again?
No.
No.
What is it?
So you're still not, do you want us to try to figure this out further? No, just move on. Move on. The answer to number four is B. That makes it read clearer.
I don't know. It sounds like they own several. I mean, I don't know. It's
all right. Well, that's just an exception to the rule. You know, it's not try. It's just trying to. Tris and this. If you don't have the apostrophe in there, if the word looks like tris and this instead of tries and buys.
But you know it's not.
Yeah, you know it's not. Okay. Well, then we'll agree to disagree on this one, ladies, okay? Number five?
A.
Everyone says A for number five?
Yes.
Okay. The Jones's house is A. So five is A. Okay, I have a feeling some people are going to love this one. Who would like to read number six? Mary Beth would? Mary Beth, can you read that one, please?
She's good at it.
Okay, Mary Beth.
Brian, since the school's homework club started, Susan and Tim's marks have been improved.
And what do you have? I have A too, because Susan and Tim have separate marks.
Weren't you just saying you read a rule that said that it would just be the second one?
Depends on what they say. If they say Susan's, then you put the first one. If they say Susan, you put the B.
Yeah, I think you put
what
they said.
Well, okay, whatever they say, put. But this is just an example. Yes, ma'am?
No, I'm sorry.
She said bingo, too.
Bingo.
No.
Bingo as in agreed.
Oh, okay.
Somebody said bingo, we were laughing at that.
Okay.
What's the correct way to say it?
Okay, well, let's move on to number seven. And this is the exact opposite of number six. B. Seven is B. After the secret text messages were revealed, Justin and Michelle's, and there's just one apostrophe because they both had the same relationship, was over. So you could just have the one apostrophe there instead of the two. Number eight. Yes. All of the country's apostrophe leaders attended the international conference after Iran's nuclear weapons tests. And I was almost thinking you could almost put an apostrophe after the weapons. What do you think?
No.
No? It's just one test? Okay. Now, here's a confusing one. Number nine, let's have a mommy read that one. We got mommies in the room? Everybody? Okay, can you read
number nine?
Yes, please.
Do you know what date Mother's Day falls on this year?
And you chose? Okay, smart cookies you. Because that's what it is in the dictionary, like Mother's Day, Father's Day, Veterans Day. Even though it's the day of all the mothers, but that's just the way it is in the dictionary. Number 10, who would like to do number 10? B? Okay. Everyone is saying B here?
Is it A?
I have A. It is not the strike of the teachers, but it's the type of strike that it is. So I have...
She is an E.
Yep, might be right.
A.
Might be right.
Thank you. I'd rather be might be right than totally wrong, so I'll take that as a compliment. Thank you.
I was just being nice.
Oh, okay.
I was just like,
I looked that up because some of these are confusing, like homeowners insurance or teacher strikes, or I had a couple of other examples written down that are just really confusing. So,
nurses' notes can be confusing.
Nurses' notes?
Depending if we're talking more than one nurse. Yeah,
if they're, yeah. Any questions back there, ladies and gents? No? Okay, then how about number 11? A? He's correct. Number 11, choose the correct sentence. Did you mail the homeowner's insurance? And they're speaking of
singular,
your own homeowner's.
You might be right.
Again, two in a row. Two in a row.
And what about homeowner's association?
Homeowner's association. It is not.
Right, I agree. Plural, not possessive. No, I agree.
You're saying homeowners association is plural, not possessive?
Right, that's correct.
That's correct. Yeah. That's correct. Because the homeowners, it's the association of the homeowners, but it's plural.
Because there's more than one homeowner, usually, when everybody has an association.
Right. You guys are right on that. So, what's the right answer? Is that what somebody said in the back? For number 9? 11? I'm sorry. 11 is A. 11 is A. Yes.
Well, when y'all own it, is it, y'all own it together?
Yeah, you own it together. Is it still A? I would say it is because it's
the husband and wife, but it's two people.
But it's the policy of yours jointly. Husband and wife.
Got it before you got married.
Well, good question. I'm still going with A. Yes.
How about none?
No apostrophe at all?
Huh?
To solve the problem, no apostrophe?
Insurance
for homeowners insurance. I mean, that's just a blanket
statement. Do you have homeowners insurance? Where
would you
put
the possibility
in that sentence? Do you have homeowners insurance? How many people own the home? 6 people could own the home.
That's a very good point. Yeah.
She might be right.
She might be right, by golly. Okay, so you know what? No apostrophe at all and homeowners insurance. No apostrophe at all. The answer is C, none of the above. Okay, let's move on, ladies and gentlemen. Unless you were take a break and we can be open for discussion. Any open discussion you guys want to have. I have 10 minutes before I leave. So if you want to get into this proofreading exercise, we can get in as far as we can. and go over some of it, or if you guys want to be open for discussion, yes, ma'am. You're going to have to speak. Can you speak up a little louder, please?
I know a lot of the problems that I've been having is with translated depositions and translation occurring and not occurring. And for a while there, I was trying to make the record beautiful by including untranslated English speaking, you know, because it wasn't translated. And I'm just wondering what other people are doing in their translated depots. You know, because sometimes our translators are not translating everything.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm sorry. I was thinking you were talking. I was thinking you were talking about untranslates coming up.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So can you repeat that question again? This is a dealing with a translator or interpreter.
Exactly. They come in and, you know, because you're swearing them in to interpret. So you should only take down what the translator is speaking. Nothing else that the witness may say or, you know, what's
but. Okay, she's saying when you're taking an interpreter depth, you swear in the interpreter that he's going to be the witness is testifying through him, he's the speaker, and so you should only take down what he says. But if the witness says something in broken English, you still have to put that in. You put what?
I put the witness, colon, and what he said.
The witness, exactly.
Right.
But then, when you go back into the Q&A, then I put, by the interpreter, perhaps resumed.
But, I'm just wondering what a lot of people are doing, because I do it the way I'll do it, you know, but...
It would be nice if the attorney would say, make sure you answer through the interpreter.
The interpreter.
So that's what I'm saying. Like, so we're really listening only to the interpreter. I mean, we do multiple things, you know, listen to three people talking at the same time.
Yes.
But through different languages, you know,
Can I interject though? Just not just to kind of like, so the uniform format manual has, I think, an example where it talks about people, like if the interpreter answers and then the witness answers in English, it does. Yeah, there's I think you're 7 point. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, there's the uniform format manual does have a way that it wants you to handle the situation if the witness speaks in addition to the interpreter, and then if they have a conversation amongst themselves, you're supposed to like. In college, you know, or I'm sorry, not college,
yes,
so the format manual has that.
Ma'am, you had just some.
I had this deposition where the witness claimed that didn't speak English at all.
She had a deaf or a witness claimed didn't speak English at all. Okay.
Answered questions in English after the interpreter answered. So my attorney wanted me to get the English answer in the transcript as well, so he could show the judge. Listen, they say they don't speak English, but they do. So, I mean, I think you have to put it in.
You do have to put it in. If it was said, you have to put it in.
A lot of times on the transcripts with an interpreter, if there is that answering by the witness in English mixed in with the interpreter, I'll put it in the parenthetical at the very beginning saying all answers are through the interpreter unless otherwise indicated. And then if I do get the witness saying yes, yes sir, whatever, on an answer, I'll put the little, you know, like you do for the attorneys, I'll put by the witness.
Okay, that's smart, and that's a good way to handle it, because you're fronting it, so to speak, at the very beginning, you're saying it could come up, and if it does, this is what you're going to see. So you're just adding an additional safeguard in there, because...
Every now and then, so you'll have to put in by the witness.
By the witness.
Instead of having to label every single answer, or, you know what I'm saying,
mm-hmm. That's a good point. I haven't taken an interpreter deck in a while, so I forgot about how those can really be confusing. They really can. Okay, any other questions? So did you guys enjoy the program so far today?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So far. So far, well, it's only going to get better from here. So any questions or comments about any of the material we went over?
I think we
pretty good.
We've covered it pretty good.
A lot of different opinions, and we've
a lot of good discussion.
Yeah.
A lot of good discussion.
Good answers.
And we still all do it like we do it.
We still all do it like we do it. That's
you
right.
Might be right.
You might be right.
I guess I think I'm right.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much.
And just wrote that down.
Okay, so I have a question for you. When the witnesses are not audibly answering, do you as a reporter say, can you speak up, or do you let the attorney do it?
Let the attorney do it.
Let the attorney do it?
Well, I was going to say, because I work in court, usually like, yeah, they don't, if nobody thinks for me, if nobody thinks to, you know, if they not yes, because a lot of times right with my eyes closed, because I'm trying to concentrate. And if I don't hear it, I don't put a yes. And it's somebody else's job to say, is that a yes? And if, you know, yeah, that, at least that's the way I take it.
I had an attorney jump my case years ago, and he said that it was not the reporter's job to tell his client how to answer.
Well, and I can see why, because, yeah, because it's like, it's maybe the other guy's going, I'm glad he didn't answer.
Exactly, right. He didn't want the answer.
Right, and so you don't want to, at least so that's my point of view.
And for the
so
answer, I just put
paren,
no response, close.
It's like,
no
you
response,
just question,
yes.
You don't get an answer, you just keep going on.
Yeah, like, it just looks like a long question, yeah, because okay. I didn't hear
several
it.
Several questions.
But I think there's a new opinion out in court where we can say nodding.
And sometimes I have attorneys like looking at me, pleading with me with eye contact, can you please say something? And I'm like, can you say something?
Exactly.
Yeah, good job, yeah.
It's his deposition.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah. Does anybody ever just say, I'm not getting an answer here?
Like, no audible response to you?
Yeah, no, I mean, like, yeah, I mean, yeah. I'm just, I thought.
Yeah, I did that.
Because there's no answer. You know, that he asked a question. Ask another question.
I did that the other day. The whole deposition was like that. His attorney and the other attorney never even told him to say anything. I'm like, I have to have an answer.
Yeah, I mean, after all, there's going to think you didn't write it down.
I can say I didn't hear it.
It was the ghost witness. No answers.
They're nodding their head and you don't
put
nodding their
head. This might be a good one.
Okay.
I just say I didn't hear your answer. I said I can't hear you. That's all I said.
Yeah.
I can't hear you.
Why didn't you get an answer? Yeah. Hear an answer.
Because you know we spoke, but it was too low. I can't hear you.
Well, it's been my experience that the judge usually leans over and says you have to answer audibly, and you have to speak up.
You're lucky you usually get that in district court. I mean, in that nice way. Because, yeah, usually they're real careful about the record and that. Oh, where we were? So, I was just going to ask a question. So, like, if somebody keeps, like, the lady in the colorful shirt that's two rows ahead of me, the deposition you're mentioning, would anybody think it would be wrong, like in that situation, to, like, eventually start putting no audible response, no audible response, no audible, instead of, you know what I'm saying?
Because he was shaking his head.
Right. I mean, would you put answer, no audible response?
Would anybody? Anything. This went on. I'm just like, I'm not getting anything.
So that's my question. Would anybody think, because I think there's, for me, like,
I would put no audible response.
Say again?
I would put no audible response.
Yeah.
He's saying if you put shakes head, nods, and that's interpreting, he doesn't like to do that. So just no response. Yes, ma'am.
Some people do it like when the shakes get up, who's get up and down, side to side. That's what the uniform format says.
Roller coaster has been. Okay, well, thank you guys very much for participating and being a great audience.
there you go. You're done. How easy was that? I hope you had a great time taking this program. Now you have a few more CEUs to add to your CEU bucket there. Now remember, if you're taking one of our longer courses, please wait until you finish all the seminars before you send us your answers. And please try to, if you're going to put them in an email, copy them in one straight vertical line separated by the different course titles. And that makes it easy for me to grade, makes it go a lot faster, and I don't make any mistakes. Well, not so many. Okay. And also, you can scan them in order and send them to me as well. Remember, we are always putting new content up here. Every year, we will have at least 4 to 10 more hours worth of CEUs that you can get here from the comfort of your home. So if you know more court reporters that would like to get their credits that way, please let them know about it. And remember, you're home for CEUs online, Jeff Jess's Seminars, where you can get your CEUs online anytime.